Once again, Christian greetings to all our valued listeners and viewers throughout the whole world, more particularly to all Shepherd's Rod believers, most especially to our beloved brothers and sisters in the United States of America. Special greetings to our brethren in Colorado and Georgia, to our brethren in Kansas, in Fiji Island, in Mexico, Spain, and Africa, to the United Kingdom, and also to our brethren in Australia, and to the rest of the 144,000 living saints scattered abroad, greetings. May the good Lord bless you, brothers and sisters. This is our episode number 12 on the subject, the chronological order of events. And we dedicate it particularly to our brethren, Brother Steve and Sister Corinne, and to the rest who are listening and viewing this program. And I think at this time, we need to have a complete understanding concerning all the resurrection and also concerning all the translation. For it would be difficult to us to understand the chronological order of events unless we have a clear conception concerning the granting of rewards as illustrated in the parable in Matthew 20 as one penny. So the significance, that symbolization in 2SR 222, saying to us, R 222, in our study of the seven seals, we reserved for future explanation the following scripture. And I heard a voice in the midst of the four beasts say, a measure of wheat for a penny, and three measures of barley for a penny. Revelation 6, verse 6. Again, we turn the reader's attention to the fact that the voice came from the throne. And this throne is in the sanctuary, within the sanctuary. And then it says, see chapter 5, verse 11. Therefore, the price of the cereals is fixed by the great judge. So what is the price of the cereals? One penny. So according to this reading, that the price of the cereals is fixed by the great judge, our heavenly Father. And the word fix can easily be understood, meaning it could no longer be altered. It could no longer be changed. It could no longer postpone or whatever it is. The granting of the rewards, because the statement, the price of the cereals, which is represented by one penny, is pointing to the granting of the rewards. Let us distinctly separate the granting of the rewards, which is bookwork transaction, and the granting of the rewards, which is actual or the material side. When it is referring to the saints who died, the granting of rewards, which is bookwork, is to inscribe their names in the book of resurrection. But the material side is to resurrect them in actuality, or literally, they will be physically resurrected. So we need to distinctly separate the granting of rewards that occurred on the heavenly sanctuary and that is done in the most holy place. So here in 2SR 189, during Christ's ministration in the holiest of all,
which is a throne of judgment, of blotting out sins and granting of rewards. So there are only two proceedings to be performed in the most holy place, and that is the granting of rewards and also the blotting out of sins. And we know that the blotting out of sins is called the beginning work of the judgment of the dead. But the granting of rewards, inscribing their names in the book of resurrection, is called the closing work. So let us distinctly separate the beginning work and the closing work, both heavenly sanctuary and earthly sanctuary. So beginning work and closing work. But we focus first our attention to the proceedings that occurred in the heavenly sanctuary. First, blotting out of sins, it is the beginning work. And then after their sins are blotted out, then the next step is the closing work, which is those saints by which their sins had been blotted out. After that blotting out of sins, then their names will be inscribed in the book of resurrection. And that is called the first aspect of the judgment, as is stated in Answerer. So let us read. In Answerer number 5, on page 30 and page 31, you can read the entire page at your own leisure. But at this time, we will read only the last part on page 30. It says, this is the first aspect of the judgment, and being only a bookwork, Daniel 7 verse 10, a work that does not disturb either the dead in the graves or the living in the church, it takes place in heaven. So the first aspect of the judgment is only book work. We already explained the beginning work, which is pertains to the dead. We are focusing first most holy place. Do not forget that. Not yet in the holy place. Most holy place. The proceedings in the most holy place. The first aspect of the judgment in the most holy place is blotting out of sins. And it is called the beginning work of the judgment of the dead. And the second aspect in the proceedings in the heavenly sanctuary in the most holy place is the granting of rewards. And it is called the closing work of the judgment of the dead. And it is inscribing the names of the righteous in the book of resurrection. So in that case, we can easily understand that the proceedings in the heavenly sanctuary is clustered by God by resurrection. And it is connected to the parable in Matthew 20 that there are particular rule, 3 hours schedule. Now, in page 31, it says, the second aspect is not a book work, but an actual separation of the dead on the resurrection day and of the living on the day of purification. The righteous dead, it says, are raised, and the unrighteous left in their graves. The righteous living are sealed to live eternally, and the unrighteous left to die. Ezekiel 9, verse 2 to 7. Thus the worthy dead are judged to rise in the first resurrection, and the unworthy in the second resurrection. Whereas the worthy living are judged to live on, and the unworthy judged to die. And this is the simple reason for the judgment. Answerer number 5, pages 30 and page 31. So we called it the proceedings in the heavenly sanctuary as the spiritual side. But the occurrences on the earthly sanctuary, we called it the material side, the actual event. So hoping that God would help us to understand it clearly, my dear brothers and sisters. So let us connect our subject on the parable in Matthew 20. Now, we already emphasized yesterday that there must be an absolute significance. Why is it that the parable in Matthew 20 connect the vision of John on Revelation 6 verse 6? There must be an accurate significance. And we also already proved with absolute fact that whatever the truth concerning the parable in Matthew 20, the particular object in view are not revealed to any other company in the five distinct calls except to the last call, which is the 11th hour call. Now, what we need to study is that since the 11th hour call are divided into two sections, the first section is the first of the first fruits, and the second section is the first fruit. Now, logically, whatever understanding concerning the parable in Matthew 20, such particular object in view must be revealed first by Jesus Christ to the first of the first fruits before it will be revealed to the rest of the 144,000, by which we commonly called as the first fruits. So that statement in 2TG 43 on page 12 saying, it follows that without the 11th hour message and servants, the church Zion would be left sleeping forever, never to behold the feet of him who brings these good tidings, of him who publishes peace, and never to put on her beautiful garments, never to be fitted for the kingdom. 2TG 43, page 12. And since Zion mentioned there is the one mentioned in Isaiah 52, verses 1 and 2, by which the shepherd's rod is very plain, that message, Isaiah 52, verse 1 and 2, is directed to the 144,000 living saints. Now, let us read again to symbolic code, number 9, page 9. It says, awake, awake, put on thy strength, O Zion, put on thy beautiful garments, O Jerusalem, is to the 144,000, to those whom John saw standing with the lamp on antitypical Mount Zion. So, the message in Isaiah 52, verse 1 and 2, is addressed to the 144,000 living saints, by which the shepherd's rod declared clearly in 2TG 43, page 12, that without the 11th hour servants and message, the church would be left sleeping forever and never to be fitted for the kingdom. Undoubtedly, the servants mentioned there, they are the first of the first fruits, and they must be the last ordained ministry, by which the very first people by which they were commanded by God to proclaim such message is first to the 144,000, to the 144,000 living saints. And since the shepherd's rod is very plain in the old symbolic code, in 9 symbolic code 1 to 12, page 7, 9 symbolic code 1 to 12, page 7, it says, let us all, as a Davidian band, remember that we are called to the high office of conservators of the gospel, restorer of the old paths, repairers of the bridge. We are called as the first of the first fruits. It says, from Laodicea, and thus we are to serve as saviors to Laodicea and of Laodicea. Obadiah, verse 17 and verse 21. So that statement is very plain that the first of the first fruits, they are the Davidian. So, since this message is purely taken from the Shepherd's Rod publications, logically, it must be addressed to the Davidian because it will not benefit, it cannot profit to any of them who do not believe that the Shepherd's Rod is the rod of God, that the Shepherd's Rod is the message of God. So it must be addressed only to those who believe this message. And they are represented by the first of the first fruits. I remember the statement given by B.T. Hotep that saying that what a wonderful privilege to be among the first of the first fruits. Let me see if we could find that statement in 1TG. Or what a wonderful privilege, my dear brothers and sisters, you and I, if we will be faithful to be among that special company, the first of the first fruits. 1TG, it says here in 1TG 23, page 9, it says, and how glad we ought to be for the privilege to be among the first of the first fruits. So that is, I think, the highest privilege that had ever bestowed by heaven, to be among that most special company, to be among the first of the first fruits. And in Leviticus of the Davidian, page 3, it is called the vanguard or the advance guard. It says here in Leviticus of the Davidian on page 3, it says, second, it purports itself to be the first of the first fruits of the living, the vanguard from among the present-day descendants of those who composed the early Christian church. Who composed the early Christian church, brothers and sisters? Of course, pointing to the 120 disciples who received that Pentecostal power on the day of Pentecost. So, first of all, brothers and sisters, we need to distinctly separate the first of the first fruits and the first fruits themselves. The shepherd's rod plainly told us here in the old symbolic code, in two symbolic code number 10 page 9, it says, from these scriptures we are not, however, to draw the erroneous conclusion that all of the first fruits are demanded by the Lord. God requires only an offering of the first of the first fruits, as is proved by the fact of the wave-sheaf presented to the Lord before the individual could harvest his crop of first fruits. To symbolic code number 10, page 9. So the shepherd's rod declared clearly that it is an erroneous conclusion that all of the first fruits are demanded by the Lord. God required only first of the first fruits. Or in other words, brothers and sisters, once the Lord can got a group of people, and that group of people must be the first of the first fruit among the media. Among the media, there might be possibility that the first of the first fruits are also 120. Although it is not a big deal, but the possibility is there because type and antitype should exactly fit. That is the divine principle given by the shepherd's rod in Answerer number 3, page 23, Manas Arpakit edition, page 73, and also Great Controversy 399. But 100% for sure, the first of the first fruits are not the 144,000 living saints. There might be possibility that the first of the first fruits is not a part of that number. There might also be possibility that they are included in that number. And still, it is not a big deal. The most important part in this study is the period of time. We focus our attention first to the first of the first fruits. The first of the first fruits is demanded by the Lord. The Lord requires it, not the first fruits. Because the first fruits are illustrated, cut out without hands. Now, I would like to read again, brothers and sisters. First, track number three, page 49. It says, at the former coming of the Son of Man, the stone which smote the great image was cut out without hands, meaning without man's aid and by the Lord himself. If the description concerning the first fruits without man's aid is perfectly corroborating that the Lord do not demand us concerning the 144,000, because the 144,000 is cut out without hands, meaning without man's aid. In track number 8, page 63, it says, the stone, Daniel 2, verse 45, Zechariah 3, verse 9, the 144,000 cut out of the mountain, the Laodicean church, without hands, without human help. Track number 8, page 63. If it is without human help, plainly indicating that God do not require us to do such work, because if there is man's help, then indicates that God require us. God does not demanded us. That is erroneous idea. That is erroneous conclusion. When it pertains to the first fruit, all the things that pertains to the first fruits, it is Jesus Christ that will do such work. And we read it several times, saying in 2 TG 44 page 37, who gathers the first fruits if the first fruits gather the second fruits? But the answer found in 2 TG 44 37, the Son of Man therefore gathers the first fruits. Who gathers the first fruits? Jesus Christ. Is there any man's help? No man's help. No human help, no human aid. Therefore, our sighing and crying is not for the gathering of the 144,000, but to receive the seal of the living God, to obtain the seal. But the most important thing concerning sighing and crying is the period of time. There is an alluded period of time. I know it's really hard to direct immediately to the idea that I wish to convey, because we need to understand everything, brothers and sisters. Now, for example, the prophecy in Hosea chapter 1 and chapter 2. We will be focusing to the climactic event of that vision. First, I would like to read to you here in the old symbolic code, 3 symbolic code. 5 and 6, page 4. 3 symbolic code, 5 and 6, page 4. It says here, I would like to read the statement saying, plead with your mother, plead for, saith the Lord, she is not my wife, neither am I her husband. Hosea 2, verse 2. Now, I think each one of us would agree completely that such declaration, she is not my wife, it is total rejection. It is total denial, saying she is not my wife. The Lord disowned. So that is rejection. So if you will honestly and sincerely study the shepherd's rod, it cannot be applied on the days of Bethi-Hothep. Because in the days of Bethi-Hothep, Bethi-Hothep is God's messenger, represented by Jezreel, commanded by God to give message to Amai and Ruhamah to plead to their mother so that such strange mother will be reconciled to our father, or will be reconciled to her husband. Now, let me read to you track number 4, page 5. It says, There am I and Ruhamah, with deepest anxiety, I am writing to implore you to make overtures to our strange mother, that we may effect her reconciliation, save our father from his inconsolable grief, and regladden our now unhappy home. You can read the next paragraph and also or the last two paragraphs. But the bottom line is that the message that was entrusted by God to Jezreel, which is Bethlehem, is a message of reconciliation. Therefore, in that period of time, the Seventh-day Adventist Church were not yet spewed out, were not yet rejected, although they were demoted, but they were not yet rejected as the wife of the Lord. But they were demoted because supposed to be all the messages from the husband must be channeled to his wife. But in 1930, when they rejected the message, up to 1931, the wife had been demoted. It doesn't mean that she is no longer wife. She is still the wife. But the messages of the husband, he no longer channeled to his wife, but to the eldest son, Jezreel, because of such abomination. So, I would like to read the statement here in the old symbolic code. So, let us read here in two symbolic code. Number 10. So, this is the statement given by the shepherd's rod. Two symbolic code, number 10, pages 6 and 7. It says, demoted but not yet cast out. You can read, brothers and sisters, the entire paragraph, but just to emphasize that they had been demoted, but they were not yet cast out. Remember, Jezreel is not the wife of the Lord. Ruhama, an Ammite, is not the wife of the Lord. There must be the wife of the Lord. And in the days of Bethlehem, the wife of the Lord is still the Seventh-day Adventist leadership. But they were demoted. Whatever information, whatever messages cometh from the husband, he no longer channeled to his wife, but to his eldest son, represented by Jezreel. And that is the DSDA organization, channeled through Brother Hotep. But God gave ample time so that the wife should repent, to be reconciled to God. But such message of reconciliation, there is a boundary line. There is a boundary line, brothers and sisters. Ruhama and Ammi, they will be continually pleading to that ministry, the Seventh-day Adventist leadership, as long as the period of time alluded for that message of reconciliation is still unfinished. But when the appointed time, the boundary line is finished, this is the message in the old symbolic code. In three symbolic code, 5 and 6, page 4, it's easy to understand that this last Jezreel that had been raised by God is to inform Ruhama and Ammi that the mother by which they were pleading is already rejected by God as his wife. Now let us read again, 3 symbolic code, 5 and 6, page 4, saying, plead with your mother, plead for, saith the Lord, she is not my wife. So this reading is pointing to the boundary line that that wife that had been given the chance to be reconciled to God, to accept the message of the shepherd's rod, the boundary line came. And still, they continually reject the message. And that is the time by which they were cast out. The statement, not yet cast out, brothers and sisters, indicates that there is a period of time by which they will be cast out. And since that leadership is represented by antitypical soul, so it's easy to comprehend when will be the period of time by which antitypical soul is rejected by God. And that is the time when God commanded the prophet Samuel to anoint David. So, I would like to read again, brothers and sisters, the statement here in tract number 8 on page 47 and page 48. It says, why David a type? Inevitably because he is the only one who perfectly fits the antitype, the leadership in the time of the loud cry of the third angel's message. This being so, then it necessarily follows that Saul, the first king who reigned over Israel and who was largely responsible for the early experience of David's life, is a type of the church leadership in the period preceding the loud cry, the leadership which was raised up in 1844, and for the sole purpose of gathering the 144,000, the first fruits of the kingdom. In its case, type perfectly matches antitype. Track number 8, pages 47 and page 48. So to repeat again, brothers and sisters, we need to study the period of time, the alluded period of time given by God to the Seventh-day Adventist leadership represented by the wife of the Lord to repent and accept the message of the rod to be reconciled to God. But as far as the Bible and the spirit of prophecy is thus concerned, they will reject the message. They will not accept the message. Now, for example, here on selected messages, book 1, 122, it says, are we hoping to see the whole church revived? That is pointing to the Seventh-day Adventist leadership. Selected messages, book 1, 122. Are we hoping to see the whole church revived? That time will never come. Now in 2SR, 2SR page 233, it says, if the leaders in God's church at the present time should accept the 11th hour call, it would be out of the ordinary. But should they reject it, God cannot start a new movement, for there is time no longer. But in this reading, brothers and sisters, we know that it was already predicted beforehand that they will reject the message. They will not accept the message. So to repeat again, only Jezreel that have a living communication from heaven, from God. And he is the only one by which the information was given by God, represented by our Father, that that wife, that ministry that had been supposed to be given the chance to repent, the boundary line is finished and they still continually reject the message. Therefore, God raised up Jezreel, represented by the eldest son, to inform Ruhama and Amai that there is no wrong for sighing and crying, but they were sighing and crying to the wife by which they considered as their mother, by which that wife is no longer recognized by God as his wife. God declared, she is not my wife, thus saith the Lord. That is the statement that we read, brothers and sisters. So here in 2TG, 2TG number 6, page 18. Now, what is it all about? It is not too difficult to see. The one to whom God speaks, Jezreel, represents a prophet. His brother and sister, Amai and Ruhama, can only represent the church membership, both male and female. In actuality, Jezreel must deliver God's message to them. So that is the statement given by the voice of inspiration, that Jezreel, the eldest son, represents the prophet. And this Jezreel, he will deliver God's message to Amai and Ruhama in actuality. Then if you will be saying that at this time, there is no more Jezreel and all of us is Amai and Ruhama, then tell me, in what way does Bethihotep delivered a message to us in actuality? Because the word actuality, that is pointing that such messenger is living. If you will send message by letter, then you are sending message not in actuality. Even if you are still alive, or even if you are living. For example, you will wrote a message from your brother or your sister in a far distant place by letter. Then you are not sending message to your brother and to your sister actuality, but through the medium of letter. So the word actuality, actual, that must be an actual fact. Now here in 2TG 21, page 9, it says, the command, say ye unto your brethren, Amai, unto your sisters, Ruhama, in itself explains that God is speaking to Jezreel. Now, brother and sisters, at this time, Bethi-Hotep were already dead for many years, and God never speak to a dead prophet. It says that this symbolization, allegorical prophecy, indicates that God is speaking to Jezreel. In the days of Bethi-Hotep, God is speaking to Jezreel, and the message that was given by God to Jezreel, which is Bethi-Hotep, is a message of reconciliation. And it is illogical that God rejected the Seventh-day Adventist Church as his wife and then sent message of reconciliation. When God reject, brothers and sisters, he no longer accept it, brothers and sisters. There are instances that God reaccepted his people, but not with the same position. And the same with Lucifer. Lucifer, according to the spirit prophecy, he will accept the invitation of Christ, but with a condition that he will be also put again to the same position. But God no longer place him in the same position. If he will repent, he must repent. Look at the Jewish people that had been rejected by God. They will be reaccepted for salvation, but no longer as his ministry. So what I'm trying to emphasize that in the days of Bethi-Hotep, the Seventh-day Adventist Church as the wife of the Lord was not yet rejected, not yet cast out. Because God will not cast out without first sending a message of period of repentance so that they could reconcile to God. And that is the period of time that was given by God to be reconciled to her husband. But to repeat again, there is a boundary line. And only God knows when would be that boundary line. But for sure, when that boundary line will arrive, God will raise up Jezreel to inform Ruhama and Amai. And such rejection, which is the boundary line, was illustrated by the type, the rejection of King Saul. And God anointed David. Brothers and sisters. Now let us read Answerer number 1 on page 32 and page 33. But later to the Laodicean leadership represented by the angel, he makes an even more drastic decree, an unconditional, unequivocal, sharp and final statement that he will spew them out, thus bringing the Laodicean church government to an abrupt and cataclysmic climax. At this very time, then, the church is to undergo a thorough house cleaning, a change of administration and organization, even as anciently the kingdom was rent from Saul and given to David. 1 Samuel 15, verse 28. And just as David, the eighth son of Jesse, was not chosen until the succession of his seven brothers had one by one passed in review, so the house of David, Zechariah 12, verse 8, Testimonies, volume 5, page 81, the church freed from the tares, the eighth church in the New Testament succession, was not to come into being until the succession of seven had passed one by one. Now, brothers and sisters, the type picture the true object in view with unmistakable evidence. In 1 SR 226, the types themselves are not the true object, no more than a photograph is. It says, but it is a representation which pictures an unmistakable evidence, the object in view. You see, pictures an unmistakable evidence, the object in view. Now, I will no longer at this time identify who are they, the seven antitypical brothers of David. To repeat again, brothers and sisters, in that picture, it is not difficult to understand. You might evade, you might reject, but brothers and sisters, you cannot deny the reality, the absolute reality. That I would like to enumerate all the entities in the type. We have Saul, then we have Samuel, then we have Jesse, then we have the seven brothers of David, and then number eight, David. So that is the type, brothers and sisters, which pictures with unmistakable evidence the particular object in view. Who is Saul? The leadership of the Seventh-day Adventist Church. Leadership of the Seventh-day Adventist Church. Who is Samuel? That is Sister Ellen G. White. Who is Jesse? Being the father of David. That is the DSDA organization. DSDA organization from 1930 to 1955. Therefore, from this organization came out the seven brothers of David. Now, I would like to go directly to the symbolization of number seven, completeness. Completeness, pointing to all shepherd's rod believers that these seven antitypical brothers of David must exist first before David, and they will pass one by one before the existence of the eight churches. Now, I will no longer enumerate one by one, but we will be focusing to the period of time. To the period of time. So, we need to ascertain clearly when thus antitypical soul had been rejected by God. So, that is the most important question. When thus antitypical soul, which is the leadership of the Seventh-day Adventist Church, had been rejected by God? When God says, you are no longer my king. So God rejected soul. On the Seventh-day Adventist Church, God declared, you are no longer my wife. She is not my wife. So this message is addressed to all Ruhama and Amai, the legitimate children, the 144,000 living saints. Remember, one of the predicted events by which this World War II will be resumed, brothers and sisters, at the time when this antitypical Emmanuel could be able to say, my father and my mother, brothers and sisters. But although at that time, Emmanuel could not yet be able to refuse evil and choose the good. But he is already capable to say, my father and my mother. Now, I would like to read tract number 14, page 32 and page 33. It says, the overthrow of Israel to occur before Emmanuel could learn to differentiate evil from good. So Emmanuel is not yet capable to differentiate how to refuse the evil and choose the good. But the fact is, Emmanuel could be able already to discern who is his mother and who is his father, according to the shepherd's rod. Now, I would like to read tract number 14, page 38. And for sure, Emmanuel, which is Ruhama and Amai, the only reason that they had been able to recognize who really is their mother, who really is their father, is through the information given by Jezreel. Because according to the vision, Ruhama and Amai is still continually pleading, sighing and crying to that wife, to that leadership by which the boundary line is already finished and God already rejected that leadership, declaring, she is not my wife, as represented by the rejection of Saul. And through the message of Jezreel, they have been awakened that they were mistaken. They thought that leadership are still the leadership of God, not knowing that such ministry represented by the wife are already rejected by God. And at the time that such information was given to them, then they will be looking to David, no longer King Saul, because King Saul was already rejected. And then they will be looking for David, the eight church in the New Testament succession. Now, let us read tract number 14, page 38. It says, "For to know their God aright through the Son," so it utters the impossibility that you could rightly recognize the Heavenly Father, God the Father, with any other medium except only through the channel of His only begotten Son, which is Jesus Christ. And then it says, "And to know their church aright through timely truth is what brings life eternal." Or in other words, since timely truth is also represented by the present truth, it utters the impossibility that you have been able to recognize Jesus Christ, the Son of the living God, in any other medium except through the medium and the channel of present truth. That is very plain in this reading in tract number 14 on page 38. So such acknowledgement, brothers and sisters, concerning Jesus Christ and concerning God the Father, without the present truth, is only lip service. It did not really come from the bottom of our hearts. That is lip service according to the voice of inspiration. Now, let us now focus our attention. When does the appointed time by which that wife is rejected by God? Now, let us focus first to the representation of King Saul. Now, I would like to read the old symbolic code. Let us read the statement. Old symbolic code, one symbolic code, number 6, page 9. It says, "Therefore," one symbolic code, number 6, page 9. "Therefore, after the first and second angel's messages were presented to the people, at that time, their probation closed and their destinies were unalterably fixed, either for eternal life or eternal death, as was the case with Saul, king of Israel." One symbolic code, number 6, page 9. So, it was illustrated to the rejection of King Saul, the king of Israel, brothers and sisters. And that is, according to the reading, after the first and the second angel's messages were presented to the people. Now, brothers and sisters, the first and the second angel's messages, we know that it was first applied to the judgment that pertains to the dead. But we know that that is directly applied in the judgment that pertains to the living. Now, brothers and sisters, when does the perfect fulfillment of the proclamation of the first and the second angel's messages? Because the statement is very plain. After the first and second angel's messages were presented to the people. Now, I would like to read early writing. Early writings, pages 260 and 261. It says, "Those who rejected the first message could not be benefited by the second, neither were they benefited by the midnight cry, which was to prepare them to enter with Jesus by faith into the most holy place of the heavenly sanctuary. And by rejecting the two former messages, they have so darkened their understanding that they can see no light in the third angel's message, which shows the way into the most holy place." Early writings, 260 and 261. So, the perfect arrangement of the parable and the vision is that first angel's message, second angel's message, midnight cry, and then the third angel's message. What is the difference between these three? First, second, and the midnight cry, and the third angel's message. Now, I would like to read 2SR. 2SR, page 181. It says, "The midnight cry was first proclaimed prior to 1844. And the coming of the bridegroom was Christ's coming to the most holy place in the heavenly sanctuary for the investigative judgment of the saints. The investigation being in two sections. First, the judgment for the dead, and the second, for the living. The cry must be repeated. Otherwise, we would have no present truth for the time of the judgment of the living. So here, the voice of inspiration are plainly telling us that first angel's message, second angel's message, and the midnight cry proclamation must be proclaimed while Jesus Christ is in the holy place. Whereas the third angel's message must be proclaimed at the time when Jesus Christ entered to the most holy place. Although, according to 2 SR 181 and 182, in the time of William Miller, it is contrary to the proper application of the parable because the arrangement is, brothers and sisters, not in proper order. The arrangement is first angel's message, then midnight cry, and then second angel's message. So it is contrary to the proper application of the parable. But this is the groundwork from 1833 to October 21, 1844. This is the proclamation of the first angel's message, the midnight cry, and the second angel's message. And the very last that had been proclaimed is the second angel's message in October 22, 1844, immediately after the disappointment. But in the proper application of the parable, brothers and sisters, it must be first the first angel's message, then second angel's message, then the third is the midnight cry. And this message must be proclaimed before Jesus Christ entered to the most holy place. But at this time, it is called already the second coming of Christ in the most holy place. Because October 22, 1844 is the first coming of Jesus Christ. So those who reject the first angel's message in the judgment for the living, they could not be able to understand the second angel's message and also the midnight cry and also the loud cry of the third angel's message when Jesus Christ will enter to the most holy place. So let us focus our attention, brothers and sisters, to the proclamation of these three messages. And these three messages must be proclaimed prior to the time when Jesus Christ will enter to the most holy place, according to 2 SR 181. But this is the perfect fulfillment of the prophecy, which is called the second coming of Christ in the most holy place. Now, I would like to connect to you another angle on this prophecy. And to remind brothers and sisters, let us read again track number 6, 55 and page 56. So let us read. The scriptures make clear that while in the sanctuary, Christ receives the kingdom. So while Jesus Christ is still in the heavenly sanctuary, Jesus Christ receives the kingdom. What does it mean by Jesus Christ receives the kingdom? Let us connect answerer. Answerer number 2, let us read, brothers and sisters. It says that acquires ownership of it. Answerer number 2, page 88. Bringing into prophetic focus the same event Jesus declared parabolically, a certain nobleman went into a far country to receive for himself a kingdom and to return. Luke 19 verse 12. Note that he receives the kingdom, meaning acquires ownership of it while he is away, not when he returns. So Jesus Christ acquires ownership of it. Whose kingdom is that? The kingdom church. The 8 church in the New Testament succession. That is the most important thing in this study. Remember in Spiritual Gifts, book 1, page 127, it says that Sister White say, as I saw a very large company profess the name of Christ, but Jesus Christ does not recognize them as his. The same with that many parables in the Bible when Jesus Christ says, I never know you. Depart from me. I never know you. That is a very embarrassing, brothers and sisters. That is why we, if you are really a true believer, honest and sincere, there is no reason for us to boast, brothers and sisters. Our own righteousness is only filthy rags in the sight of God. Isaiah 64 verse 6. So what we need to do is to humble ourselves and plead to God that when Jesus Christ will visit the earth, that second invisible coming of Jesus Christ to this earth, He will recognize us. That is the most important, that Jesus Christ would not deny us. And the only way that we could be rest assured that Jesus Christ will recognize us, we need to humble ourselves, to bow down very low, because God hates boastful and proud brothers and sisters. So, to repeat again, according to this reading, what does it mean he receives the kingdom? He acquires ownership of it. That before he will return, whoever that a church in the New Testament succession, whoever that group of people, God acquires ownership of them. God recognizes them as he is. While Jesus Christ was still in the heavenly sanctuary. Now let us go back again to our reading in track number 6, pages 55 and page 56. The scriptures make clear that while in the sanctuary, Christ receives the kingdom. When? After the thrones are cast down. What thrones that are cast down? 2 TG 12:29, Revelation 20 verse 4. That is the quotation in that reading in 2 TG number 12, page 29. And what is Revelation 20 verse 4? Track 15, page 18. They are called lesser thrones. It is not the thrones that had been cast down in October 22, 1844. That is the thrones in Daniel 7 verse 9 and 10. That thrones that had been cast down indicates that the cleansing of the sanctuary did commence. But when these thrones are cast down indicates that the cleansing is finished. Now let us read again the statement here in track number 6, pages 55 and 56. The scriptures make clear that while in the sanctuary, Christ receives the kingdom after the thrones are cast down and after the investigative judgment is completed before his second coming. That this is so is further evidenced by the parable of Luke 19:15, which states that Christ receives the kingdom and that afterwards he comes to slay his enemies. Now, let us now enumerate one by one. When does Jesus Christ receives the kingdom? After the thrones are cast down. When does the thrones are cast down? After the investigative judgment is completed. What coming? The coming in Luke 19:15. So that is the second invisible coming of Jesus Christ. Therefore, brothers and sisters, that investigative judgment cannot be in the most holy place, but rather the investigative judgment in the holy place when the investigative judgment is completed, meaning the cleansing of the sanctuary is finished. So when the thrones on Daniel 7 verse 9 and 10 are cast down, indicates the commencement of the cleansing of the sanctuary. But when the thrones in Revelation 20 verse 4, the lesser thrones are cast down, indicates that the cleansing of the sanctuary is finished. And since the cleansing of the sanctuary is finished, Jesus Christ receives the kingdom. Meaning, he acquires ownership of that kingdom church, the eight church in the New Testament succession, the house of David. Now, let us connect the statement in 1 TG. 1 TG number 18, page 14. It says, two things now stand out clearly in these verses. Number one, that the house of David must come into existence before the cleansing fountain is opened. Now, brothers and sisters, if we will be studying the cleansing fountain in Zechariah 13, verse 1 or verse 1 and 2, we know that it is in two sections. The cleansing fountain is open for sin. And the second section is the cleansing fountain is open for uncleanness. Now let us read 2SR. It says here in 2SR page 291, beginning from 290. In that day, there shall be a fountain open to the house of David and to the inhabitants of Jerusalem for sin and for uncleanness. Zechariah 13 verse 1. Note that this fountain is able to wash away two things. First, sin, and second, uncleanness. I think I will no longer elaborate, brothers and sisters, because the Bidian is familiar that the uncleanness, brothers and sisters, such uncleanness must be fulfilled when God's people will be gathered into God's kingdom. As stated in Ezekiel chapter 36. But how about sin, brothers and sisters? When it pertains to sin, that is in the heavenly sanctuary. But when it pertains to uncleanness, that it pertains to the earthly sanctuary. So let us distinctly separate sin and uncleanness. First, sin. And sin, blotting out of sins, the only place by which it will be performed is in the heavenly sanctuary. So the statement in 1 TG number 18 page 13 that before the blotting out of sins of the 144,000, the house of David must be in existence first, because it is illogical that that blotting out of sins is intended to them at the time when they themselves do not yet in existence. They did not as yet in existence. So, in other words, let us distinctly separate the house of David, which is pertaining to the first of the first fruits, and the house of David at the time when the entire first fruits are already a part of the house of David. So, we need to distinctly separate, brothers and sisters. Now, for example, here in track number 14, I would like to read track number 14 on page 32. It says, the birth of a man child, Emmanuel, to a virgin for a sign to the house of David. Isaiah 7 verse 13 and 14. The birth of a man child, Emmanuel, here, brothers and sisters, without any doubt, it must be pertaining to the living saints, the 144,000. But how about the house of David? So, the same with Isaiah 52, 1 and 2. To repeat again, let us distinctly separate the first of the first fruits and the first fruits. So, the first of the first fruits, it must be, brothers and sisters, pointing to the last ordained ministry. So, the statement, the 8 church in the New Testament succession, of course, it must begin first with the first of the first fruits. Then, we have the first fruits. Now, let us connect our study on the statement on the Leviticus the Bidian. Page 4, it says, the name Seventh-day Adventist, which this association inherits from the parent denomination, is provisional, Isaiah 62 verse 2, and only for the duration of its work within the parent denomination. Now, it is very important, this reading, Leviticus of the Bidian, page 4, it says, the name Seventh-day Adventist, so concerning the name Seventh-day Adventist, which this association inherits from the parent denomination. Who inherits the name Seventh-day Adventist Church? The Davidian. Very plain in this reading. Now, let us read another statement in the Shepherd's Rod. And can you project the statement? They inherited only for a curse. I think that is it in 1 TG? Inherited for a curse. You find it? Well, to our beloved viewers and listeners, we will continue our subject on our next episode because I could no longer read. My eyeglass is broken, so it will be difficult for me to read those passages. So we will continue this subject on our next episode, and hoping that the good Lord will bless us, brothers and sisters, and would help us. I need first to repair this eyeglass. So, thank you very much. May the good Lord bless you and have a beautiful, wonderful evening.